Okay, this is Carol Merritt on Monday, November 21st at the Atlanta History Center, talking with Lonnie King, the leaders of the Atlanta student movement and other civil rights activities in Atlanta. Mr. King, thank you so much for coming this morning.
Well, thank you very much for inviting me.
Okay. You have a lot to share with us, but what I'd like really to do is just start with your background. Where are you from? Tell me something about your parents, your family, and growing up in Atlanta.
Well, I was born in a little town called Arlington, Georgia, on August the 30th, 1936. My mother was one of 17 children. My grandfather was a pastor, a preacher. My grandmother was a housewife. My mother left Arlington to come to Atlanta.
Who was your mother's name?
My mother's name was Bertha, she married a man later on named Bertha Thrasher, but she was Bertha King at the time I was born. Her husband's name was Lonnie King. But she and my father broke up, and I was about two, I guess, and my mother got her father, my grandfather, to agree to let her leave me with them in Arlington, Georgia, while she came to Atlanta to make a way for both of us. And so my grandfather developed a real liking for his grandson, and so he would let her take me away from Arlington, Georgia until he died, believe it or not. So I was there until I was eight. And then he died when I was eight, and so my grandmother was left there at very old person by that time, and so she told my mother to come and get me because she couldn't keep up with this young boy that was running around the place. So I came to Atlanta when I was eight and enrolled at E.P. Johnson Elementary School, which is now torn down, and graduated from there and went to Howard High School, David G. Howard High School, and then on to Morehouse College later on. My mother, when I came here, was doing domestic work, $5 a day in car fare was what the going rate was. By this time, she had married a man by the name of Cosby Thrasher, who was my stepfather. He was a baker for the Southern Bakery Company. It used to be on Highland Avenue, but it's also gone now. And they were, I'd have to say, lower income people. My stepfather probably made no more than $40 a week during that time. And my mother made, what, $5 a day in car fare, so that was really not much money. Although I admit that bread was 11 cents a loaf at the time, so maybe things were a little bit different.
When were you born? What year?
August 30th, 1936. Anyway, we lived at 362 Capitol Avenue in the rear, which is now down where the stadium is, behind a fish market. Can you imagine what that was like? Anyway, it was in the middle of the ghetto, no question about it. But my mother had joined Ebenezer Baptist Church back in 1941 or 42. And so, of course, when I came to town, I joined the church when I was eight. That she was in, which is what you do, you join your parents' church. And of course, while I was there, going to church every Sunday, my mother kept me in church all the time, and when I was not at church, I was at the Butler Street YMCA, and as I look back on those days, I guess that was her way of making sure that I, quote, stayed out of trouble. But on Sundays, I would admit, I would hear Reverend Dr. Martin King Sr. preach these inspirational sermons about how bad segregation was, discrimination, so forth and so on. And I was tapped by him and others to participate in many programs when I was young there. So I organized something called the Ebenezer Youth Organization, which is still in existence down there now. But it was designed to get a group of young people into an organization where we would plan the youth activities for the church, including Youth Day once a year. But we also planned hikes, we planned picnics, we planned Thursday get-togethers at the church. It was kind of like a youth ministry, by if you use today's nomenclature. And I think from that experience, as I was growing up, you know, I was 11, 12, 13, 14, you know, I got the chance to introduce famous people like Dr. Benjamin E. Mays, who was our youth day speaker once. When I, you know, I got a chance to meet Mordecai Johnson, a number of prominent people of the time, especially theologians and educators. And those folks had a decided impact on me, along with my high school teachers. I had a lot of high school teachers who had gone to Morehouse, who had gone to Spelman, and I guess but for discrimination, they could have been doing a lot of other things.
Who were they?
Well, the most memorable one would be Mr. Marcus Beavers. He was my homeroom teacher for about 3 years. And this man seemed to believe that I had some ability. And he was constantly encouraging me to do well, plan high, and reach high, and so forth and so on. There were others, but he was the most important influence. And he's the reason why I went to Morehouse College, because of him. Having those teachers in the segregated school system of that time who showed some concern for students that they thought might have some ability, I think was very important for me. I remember Mr. Ashmore, C.M. Ashmore, who taught me health also. He went to Clark College, excellent teacher. Mr. Henry J. Furlong.
Furlong?
Furlong, F-U-R-L-O-W. Okay. Excellent, a very excellent teacher. Mr. Roy Wolf, who went to Cloud College, very excellent teacher. But these teachers in my high school, and I think it was true in other schools in town, Washington High, Turner, they had, in my opinion, even though I don't think they sat down to talk about it, I think they seemed to have had a mission, which was to try and get as many of us as prepared as we could possibly be to face what they saw at that time, a segregationist world, where you had to be twice as good just to get half of what somebody else who was not black could get. But when you, you know, there's no one thing that makes anybody, it's the total environment. So I had a nurturing environment at home. My mother was a very, very devout Christian person. My stepfather was not a Christian in terms of his going to church, but he was a very bright man who had no education, but who had a lot of common sense, a lot of wisdom. Oh, and they kept me out of trouble all the time. They put me behind like you wouldn't believe if they thought I was doing something that I should not have been doing. I guess by today's standards, my mother would have been put in jail for child abuse because she clearly was not going to stand for any stuff that was going to get me in trouble. When you put that together along with the church experience and the school experience, and also the Butler Street YMCA, I've got to bring that in too. Mr. J.D. Winston, my mother put me in his charge. When I would get out of school, in the elementary school, I had to go to the Y, so I walked to the YMCA. It was several, maybe 2-3 miles from where I lived. But, you know, during that time, nobody bothered children. So I would walk to the Y and I would stay there until my mother got home, and then I could walk back home. And I knew I had better go to the Y every day or else. But having gone to the Y from the time I was in elementary school all the way up through high school, what happened? I learned how to play table tennis and swim and all that, but mostly with table tennis. I became city champion in Atlanta, and I had a chance to play a number of prominent Atlantans, black Atlantans, table tennis, and all teach them how to play. And so I met the Bill Callaways, I met the Tim Alexanders, and a number of other influential blacks around town who came to the Y. They came to the YMCA at that time to play bridge during the lunch hour. And so if it was during the summertime, the Y had hired me to work down there because I was there all the time. I may as well have been working. I was there all the time. But I used to listen to these people talk about situations, what have you. And as I look back on it now, Miss Merritt, no one experience was pivotal necessarily in my development. But I think when you put together the myriad of things that were going on in my life at an early age, a formative age, it gave rise to my, I think, having some grounding when it came time for us to move to bring about an end to segregation in Atlanta, Georgia. One more element I think is important in that equation, and that was the fact that I only went 1 year to Morehouse, and then I went to the Navy for 3 years. And while I was in the Navy, I ran into all kinds of discrimination. Now,
more so than in Atlanta?
Probably because Atlanta was so segregated until, if you stayed within your community, you might not run into that many folks who would be doing racist things to you. But in the Navy, you were in a predominantly white organization. And there was a lot of discrimination going on. Even though Truman had desegregated the military in the 40s, when I went in 54, a lot of things were still going bad. And I won't go too far except to say to you that it was a very, very humbling, informative, discriminatory experience that I had there. I had to fight for every rape that I got. I found that.
Like how?
Well, when I went to boot camp, I was, we all take aptitude tests. So they kind of rank you. And so I happened to have been, to have had the highest aptitude test of the 83 people in my boot camp. There were about maybe 5 blacks and 80 whites. So the person who had the highest GCT, aptitude test, was the one that they picked to be educational petty officer for the company. Your job as educational PO was to try to teach reading, writing, and arithmetic to the other people who were not as proficient as you in that area. And so I did that all the way through boot camp. And then I had responsibility for taking about 25 or 30 people from boot camp to catch a ship called the USS Oriskany in California. So we traveled out there by train, and we got to San Francisco, and we were told that they had gone to San Diego, and so we went to San Diego. We got to San Diego, we were told that they had come back to Alameda, California, so we came back. Make a long story short, so I had all the records. So when we got to the ship, I saluted the officer of the day, gave him the records, and we all went into something called the X1 Division, which is the Indoctrination Division. So when we got out of there, they had to assign you billets. Those were jobs. And what happened is that
they had to sign you what?
Billets, B-I-L-L-E-T-S. That's like jobs.
Okay.
What jobs are you going to do? You 30 people, what are we going to have you do while you are here on this ship? And what happened is that I had the highest aptitude with my group, and the person who had the lowest, he and I were assigned to the deck force. He was white, I was black. And the rest of the whites, I was the only black among those 30, of those 29 whites, they were sent as air controlmen, fire controlmen, personnelists, you name it. But there were 2 slots for the deck force. Now what does the deck force do in the Navy? The deck force is one that chips the paint, cleans up, scrubs up, and so forth and so on. So they took the lowest aptitude and the highest and stuck them in the deck force. That was the beginning of the discrimination that I saw in the Navy. After I was down there for about maybe a month or so, chipping paint, they then decided to make me be the person who would be in charge of cleaning up the restroom. Well, the restroom is the head. They call it the head, H-E-A-D. And if you could consider my division had about 200 people in it. And so we had this massive facility where the showers were there, the commodes, you name it, sinks. So my job became one of keeping that clean every day. It was an offense, but at the same time I did it because I was in the Navy. So what I did was I repainted the whole place, shined everything up, made it look sparkling. And as you may know, once you've cleaned a house, it's easier to keep it clean if you just do a little bit every day. You don't have to, once you've done all the major cleaning. And so I turned this into a sop job, where I only had to do a little bit of work in the morning, a little bit of work in the afternoon, and I was reading books the rest of the time. Well, before I took over the job, that's all the person had to do, was just keep the place clean. That was your full-time job. But when I turned it into a job that was no more than an hour or so a day, a third-class petty officer who was above me, because I was a seaman apprentice at the time, I was a seaman by that time, he bid me out of the job. Rather, he put in a request, because he had seniority, to take over the job, because the job now was attractive. And I had to then go back to the deck force, okay? Well, but that's the way the name works, you know. Rank has its privileges, and so I had to go back. But I learned something from that. I said, you know, even if you're picking up garbage, if you're black, and if you turn that particular venue or that job around where it becomes attractive, these racist people will take you out of that and then stick you back to something else. That was very instructive for me. Then when I went back to the deck force, I started looking around for some avenues, because I knew I was an American citizen, but also I knew I was a Negro at that time. And I knew I had few options because it was a white man's Navy. But so I applied for a position as a dental technician. But I had to go off to dental school to do that. So
why dental technician?
Well, that was the one job that showed up that looked like I might be interested in, okay? My mother wanted me to become a doctor at one point, and so I think that was the closest thing for me to do that. But anyway, I applied for it, but before I could get accepted, another job became available, that of disbursing clerk. Now, disbursing clerk is the same as a cashier at a bank. You know, you count money, you account for money, you figure payrolls, you pay the people, so on and so on. It's a cushy, white-collar job in the Navy, akin to a personnelist who handles all the paperwork for your transfers and what have you, personnel actions. So I applied for it, and I went down to see Ensign J.C. Claren, who was in charge of the place, to pass in my papers. He wanted to speak to me and told me that he didn't think that I ought to come down there, that I was not going to be considered. And I asked him why. He said, well, we don't want any Negroes down here. I said, well, but my mother thought that they pay taxes like everybody else. Well, we don't want any Negroes down here. In other words, you need not apply. That was what he was telling me. And of course, I could feel the daggers when I came into the end there. I went to the chaplain of the ship. That's the preacher on the ship. And I told him about my experience. He said to me, oh, they didn't say that. I said, yes, they did. Well, I assumed that he was going to get with me to go down there to talk about it. He did nothing. Almost whipped, I decided to go and talk to my division officer, who was a Lieutenant J.G. by the name of Horn, H-R-N, from Louisiana, New Orleans, by the way. I went to see Lieutenant J.G. Horn, and I told him what had happened. I'll be honest with you, I really wasn't expecting much out of that because he was from the South and I knew how Southern white people were about black people and opportunity. But I still went, I followed the chain of command and I went to see him. He didn't say anything. He said, come with me. He took me down to the dispersing office and he said to Ensign Clary, Mr. King, he called me Mr. King, one of the few white people to ever do that. He said, and Mr. King tells me that you said that you didn't want any Negroes down here. Is that true? Well, yes, because all these young men who are here from the South, Alabama, Georgia, and they don't want to have him down here. Lieutenant J.G. Horn told him, I will give you until in the morning to put his name in the paper to transfer it down here. And if he is not transferred down here by the morning, I'm going to personally go to the Chief of Naval Operations and see how do you get your commission. And he didn't say any more. He said, come on, Mr. King, let's go. And we left, and he said, we will go to the Chief of Naval Operations if he doesn't do it by tomorrow. He said, this is outrageous. Clarence, I think, upset the man because he was very upfront about it. You know, it wasn't in the end is he's not qualified or none of that. It was, we don't want him down here. You know, during that time, people would say what that was really on their mind. Nowadays, folks are more subtle. They run all other kind of games on you, but that was very clear, black and white. No blacks should be coming in here. So I was transferred the next morning, and when I got down there, of course, nobody spoke to me at all for the first day or two. And here I am down here now to be a trainee, to learn how to do this work. But nobody wanted to talk to me. So how was I going to learn the work if nobody talked to me? It was a freeze. So finally, a guy named John Bloom, B-L-O-O-M, from Arizona, came over to me after about the third or fourth day, and he said, my name is John Bloom, and can I help you learn this? Here's what we're doing. And so he sat down and showed me the book I need to be reading and all this kind of stuff. And he said, you got to learn how to type. Can you type? I said, no, I can't. He said, you got to learn how to type at least 30 words a minute within the next 90 days. I'll help you with the stuff as much as I can. I said, but it's really on you. You got to, but here's the book. You got to learn it. So I stayed on board the ship for the next 90 days, learning how to type and reading all these things. They're still not talking. Nobody talks to me but John Bloom, that one white guy. The rest of them wouldn't talk to me. So we took the test in February of 1956. About five of us, four whites and me, took the test to become an E3, which is the same as, it's above a full private. It's the next step. You become a non-commissioned officer when you become an E3. E4. So I took the exam with these other folks, and I was the only one to pass. And all of a sudden, once I got the power of being a non-commissioned officer in the group, I became a part of the leadership in that group within a few months. And the folks who wouldn't speak to me all of a sudden had to work for me, which changed the whole dynamic. And I learned, you know, that if you have the power, people, they may still hate you, but if you have the power, they're going to respond to the power. And of course, I moved on to become a second class in there. And some of these same folks, I guess once they realized I wasn't going anywhere and I was going to be their boss, you know, their attitude, their overt behavior changed. I'm not sure the attitude changed, but the overt behavior changed. Now, they did some things to me while I was there. We went to Hong Kong, and I bought clothes in Hong Kong. You know, you get them made overnight, so and so on. I bought some shoes. Bought some patent leather shoes and had them in my locker. Now, mind you now, we're all sleeping in the same area. Well, they threw one of my shoes overboard. Not both of them, just one. Okay? I mean, it's that kind of thing that people did during that time. So, and there are other little things that happened to me when I was in the Navy, but I don't think that was unique to me. I think it happened to most blacks, or many blacks who were in the Navy at the time.
Was this like leadership training for you? Did you have any idea of what leadership responsibilities you would be facing?
No, but I tell you what I did. But I did learn. I learned that if you were going to do anything, you had to be prepared. You had to study. You had to be ready, because you didn't know what the challenges were going to be. Now, by the time I left that ship, you know, I was the most popular guy on the ship because, number one, I was in charge of a lot of money, and people wanted to get advances on pay. Additionally, I became a heavyweight boxing champion on the ship. And so when you become a boxing champion, you know, all of a sudden 4,000 people go on that ship. They all know you because you've been knocking out people. So I brought in the naval thing because I got out of the Navy in 1957. And then some, you add up all of my earlier aforementioned experiences plus the Navy, and as I reflect on it now, I guess you would have to say that I was preparing myself unconsciously for what happened later on. When I got back to Morehouse in 57, I had to stand in line to register, as was the case with every college at that time, I guess. And I stood in line all day in 1957 in September with the young man whose name was Julian Bond. I didn't know him, he didn't know me, but we were there, so we talked. And I found him to be a very, very smart young man from Philadelphia, I think was where he was from at the time. And I remembered him as a person that was very impressive. So when the movement began in Greensboro, and I was reading this about it the next day in J.C. Milton's drugstore down there near the school. I went to Bond and Joseph Pierce, good friends of mine. Pierce from high school, Bond was not a friend, but someone that I knew, to talk to them about making this thing happen here. By this thing happening, I mean, let's start a sit-in movement here. And they all agreed that we should do it.
Had any of this occurred to you before the February 1st sit-in at Greensboro?
Well, let me give you something that appears to be corny, so forth and so on, but when I was a boxer in the Navy, I was being managed by a man by the name of Everett Render, R-E-N-D-E-R. Everett was my best friend in the Navy. He's from Atlanta. He was an electronic technician. When I was getting ready to get out of the Navy, he and I talked, and he said, well, Lonnie, where are you going to go? Because I had a boxing scholarship to USF at the time, University of San Francisco. I said, Render, I'm going back to Atlanta, to Morehouse. And I said to him something that ended up being rather fortuitous. I said, I believe this segregation stuff, it has to end. And I want to be there to be a part of it when it happens. And so that's why I'm going back to Atlanta. He reminded me of that when I saw him a few years ago when I was out in California just visiting. That I can't tell you why I just said that to him as to why I was coming back. And I didn't have any plans, just that if the revolution began, I wanted to be a part of it. And I think one thing that helped me was the fact that even though the Navy had discrimination and what have you out there, I went to a lot of places where I could go into places of public accommodations in the 50s and not be discriminated against in terms of service. So I'd had a chance to experience some desegregation, which took me outside of the environment that I had grown up in Atlanta, Georgia.
So, I didn't mean to interrupt your story, but you were telling about having met Julian Bond.
Yeah, I met Julian, and we started organizing.
And then Greensboro, reading about Greensboro.
The Greensboro sit-in was the catalyst for us. And we probably could have started on the 3rd or the 4th of February if we wanted to, because we've been around to the campuses to start organizing. But one of the things that I wanted us to do was to make sure that if we did decide that we were going to do it, we ought to have a large group of people, not just a few people going down there. And so that meant then that you needed to have all six campuses involved as opposed to Morehouse and Spelman. And that kind of philosophy is something that I was able to get the Committee on Appeal of Human Rights to adopt, that we should be as a group. And they got the presidents to do it too.
Just backing up a little bit, that meeting that you had in Sale Hall Annex, I think it said there were about 15 people that
yes.
showed.
Mm-hmm.
Who were they? Were they all from Morehouse, or had by that time you had gotten some of the other schools involved?
Let me be very, it's been so long, but I believe there were people there from Clark and Spelman. Mm-hmm. I don't think it was that from Morris Brown. I think Ed Ruth Borders may have been there from Spelman. I'm not sure about Marion, right? Ben Brown, I think, was there from Clark, because I had talked to Ben mm-hmm. earlier. Because his brother and I had been friends at the Butler Street Y. Because Ben was 3 years younger than me, so I really didn't know him that well mm-hmm. until I came back, and of course he was at Clark.
Uh-huh.
There were a few people from other schools. I can't tell you exactly how many, but most of them were from Morehouse at that time. Because that was where our power base was. Because I had played football at Morehouse, and so I knew a lot of people on the campus, and I was, I guess you would say, like BMOC at that time for football. I was a starting fullback and you know, ran a few touchdowns and what have you, and so a lot of people knew me.
What were you studying at Morehouse?
Well, I majored in economics, and I minored in business administration.
Okay, so there were other events that maybe kind of led up to the Atlanta student movement, like there had been that Atlanta Committee for Cooperative Action, and that book that came out of that, A Second Look.
Well, let me try to put that in context.
Okay.
M. Carl Holman was a professor of English at Clark College, now Clark AU. He and a number of other young Turks of that time, like Albert Davis, C. Miles Smith, Clint Warner, Johnny Johnson, they formed the Atlanta Committee for Cooperative Action. And they wrote a publication, or they published a document, which was called A Second Look. Mm-hmm. And what they laid out in there, through Holman's pen primarily, is that Atlanta, they challenged this notion of Atlanta's image as a city too busy to hate. I'm not sure they actually said those words like that, but the thrust of what they were saying was Atlanta is viewed as a metropolitan or as a metropolis even in that time. But if you look beneath the veneer of Atlanta, you find that I think approximately 11% of the land is controlled by blacks and so forth and so on. The blacks, I think, about 25%, 30%, 40%, about 30% of the population. They detail a number of the transgressions that whites had inflicted upon blacks. And that document, I think, was one of the source documents that Rosalind Pope used, along with Julian and some others, to write the appeal. But putting that in context, I think it was an intellectually stimulating document that was put out by those young folks, young professionals, before we ever started the movement. But we began the movement, the Atlanta student movement, with the meeting at Sale Hall, and trying to broaden the scope. And then I guess after, we went to see Dr. Samuel Williams, philosophy professor. Joe Pearson, I went to see him.
Why did you go to see him?
Well, Dr. Sam was the head of the NAACP at that time in Atlanta. And so we went to see him to get his support. And he was very enthusiastic, very supportive, and took us to He said, but you need legal help. He took us to J.C. Daugherty, who was a lawyer whose office was down the street on Chestnut, which is now Brawley Drive. That was not one of Mr. Daugherty's finest moments. He wanted several thousand dollars to represent us up front as we were moving forward. Now, mind you now, everybody is aware that this thing is rapidly spreading throughout the South. And so if you look at the papers every day, I mean, you see it coming. The question is it going to happen in Atlanta? So we, of course, declined his offer. And Dr. Williams then arranged for us to meet with Mr. Hollowell, Donald Hollowell, who was kind of new in town. And that's how we started the relationship with Hollowell, which I can talk about later on. But I don't know who did it, but I guess if I had to peg it, Ms. Merritt, I guess I'd have to say that someone told Dr. Mays or the college presidents what we were doing. And at that time, the college presidents, and maybe it's true today too, were attuned to what was happening. I guess they had to because they were the trustees for these people, students here. And so when we were in Yates and Milton having breakfast one morning, Mrs. Hill, Dr. Mays' secretary, came in to me, looking for me, came into Yates and Milton looking for me and asked me, would I come to the third floor conference room at AU? Bottom line is AU administration building at a certain time, like maybe 3 in the afternoon or something like that. I have to check out the time on that. But anyway, and I said, well, what's the purpose? She said, well, Dr. Mays wants you to come. And of course, when Dr. Mays wants you to come, you come. And so I said, well, what have I done now? And I thought about the fact that maybe it was going to be about what I was doing, but I'm going to go. So when I got there, Julian, Joe Pierce and I got there, here were some of the other people that we had already talked to who were also there, along with some other students. That's where I met Marion Wright and a bunch of other people that the presidents had brought. All six college presidents were there. And here were these students. And so Dr. Clement, who was the chairperson of the Council of College Presidents, opened up the meeting and he made a speech about what we were doing, what we were thinking about doing that he had heard, and he was speaking for the college presidents. They reminded us of their responsibility as stewards for the people whose kids had come to school here, and they thought we ought to turn this over to the NAACP, let the NAACP handle it, because it's a legal issue. By that time now, mind you now, Virginia and several other southern states were enacting anti-trespass statutes in order to deal with the situation. Well, after Dr. Clement spoke, then speaks Dr. May. Dr. May spoke. And he went on to tell us that he was the chairman of the Life Membership Campaign for NAACP, National. And that he would speak to Roy Wilkins and see if we can't get the NAACP to take over this thing and so forth and so on. And so when they finished that, and all the presidents spoke, but those two spoke first. Well, all the presidents seemed to have been okay except one. Dr. James Brawley, President Clark, said that if we went downtown to demonstrate that it would embarrass him, and that he was opposed to us doing that, he was the only one who did that. Of course, you'll find some people today who will tell you that that's not what happened, but that is what happened. After all the college presidents spoke, they rested their case. And then Clement was waiting for a response from the students. Well, we hadn't elected a leader. We were just kind of organizing grassroots. And so everybody kind of looked at me. And so I then spoke up and explained to the Council of College Presidents, and I was nervous. I was scared, to be honest with you, because I had met Mays because they introduced him when I was a child, but I'd heard these other giants. I didn't really know them at all, except that you hold these college presidents in awe. You know, you see them, but you don't really know them. You're just a little minion. So I said to the group that we thought that they had a good position about the NAACP, but that if we go to court with this, it'll take us a long time to win this battle, and there's no certainty that we'll win it. And I remember telling them that this is the time for us to organize all over the South and bring this thing to an end. And as we had this exchange, they reminded us that some of us might get killed in this thing. Hurt. And I said to them that that may be true, but in every revolution, people get hurt. And that we're prepared to go forward. Nobody with the students disagreed with me. I mean, it was like I just asserted that position, and nobody disagreed. And I think even the college presidents agreed with me, but they couldn't very well say that. You follow me? How could you not understand, as a black person, what was going on and how we could possibly change this thing? But the uncertainty of the thing, I think, was what was bothering the older people, because they'd seen more years, all those years of segregation, and they'd seen other attempts at trying to end this stuff. And they ended with people either losing their jobs or losing their lives or having to leave town. Well, Dr. Clement then said, well, if you are going to go forward, here is what we recommend. We recommend.
So that meant that he was prepared,
I think,
that you would say that you were going to go forward.
I think they were. Well, here's what he said. We believe that you ought to set forth in writing your grievances so that the world will know why you were doing this. And he went on basically to say that, you know, we are institutions of higher education. We ought to just do something without it being clearly articulated in a scholarly way while we're doing it. Now, I really believe they thought that if we issued the manifesto, that would make us feel okay.
I think they thought that.
And so we went along with it because it made sense. But they wanted us to kind of hold up, and we said, we will hold up and write the appeal. We will do that. And so I appointed a committee to write the appeal, headed by Rosalind Pope Walker, Rosalind Pope, with Julian and some others on it. I think I put Brinson on too, Albert Brinson, I believe. Dr. Clement said, I will raise the money to pay for it. So we agreed to put it in all the major newspapers in Atlanta. And also, yeah, that's it. So Clement raised $12,000 from his sources. $12,000, that's a lot of money at that time.
I was wondering who those sources might be.
All I know is that he raised the money out of New York. Well, I would imagine that their foundation people. I'm not sure. I don't know where Dr. Clement's papers are, but that's something that we may want to take a look at and find out where he got the money from. I do know that we left $8,000 over there at AU. We only used $4,000, so the rest of it was there in our name. But when I did check it out back about 5 years ago, it was spent. It was all gone. Somebody had used it. But be that as it may, we used $4,000 of those dollars to put those ads in the three major papers, and also we wanted to put it in the Atlanta World, but they refused. But they refused to take the ad.
And what were the three major papers?
It was Atlanta Journal, the Atlanta Constitution, with the two major papers. That was it. Atlanta Journal, Atlanta Constitution. The World wouldn't run it. That was the third paper. But they would not run it. Interesting, there was a black paper that wouldn't run the ad.
Did the New York Times run it?
Yes. The New York Times ran it after it was run by the papers here. It created such an intellectual discussion that it was run by them for free, full page. Yeah, we didn't pay for it. It was a free. Because it basically stated a ubiquitous point. Segregation was everywhere in the South. And so whatever we said about Atlanta was true about Birmingham, Nashville, Jacksonville, you name it. And so I think that's why the New York Times people reprinted it. Well, while Julian and Rosalind and others were writing the appeal, and we brought it back to the Council of College Presidents, they didn't do anything, but they heard it. But it was our document.
Mays said that he wrote the first three paragraphs in an interview. Benjamin Mays, in an interview with Fenton Ford, thought that he had written the first three paragraphs.
No, he didn't.
Okay,
he
I wanted to get that clear.
He didn't. Well, I'm going to put this, if Dr. Mays wrote the first three paragraphs, he did it in concert with Rosalind Pope. Because Rosalind was the wordsmith. She was the one, and I'll ask her if Dr. Mays was with her at all on that. Because I had them out there working on that, and it's possible that Mays did get involved with them, but I'm not aware of that, okay? But I will ask her that. She called me last night, so I'm going to call up and ask her. Ask her about that. But I do know that it was a document that caused much consternation in the white community in Atlanta and much pride in the black community. The consternation in the white community, I think, could be summed up by Governor Vandiver's comments, Ernest Vandiver. Governor Vandiver told the press after the appeal had been written that this could not have been written by any college students in Georgia. He didn't say white or black, but if you say any college student in Georgia, he's not white or black, that it certainly wasn't written by the kids at the AU Center. With the clear implication being, if not directly stating, that it had to have been written in Moscow. So you have to understand that during that time, we were going through in America the Cold War. And the worst thing that could happen is that for you to be called a communist. So everybody would go on the other side of you. You know, buzzwords. America is very good at these symbols and these buzzwords. And they get people, you know, I'm a conservative. You're a liberal. I mean, you see people campaigning and a conservative will say, this other person is a liberal, and that's a code word. Cold War, communism. Communism was a code word, which would cause all the folks to say, oh, that's a very simplistic way of saying that these are not really these students, but these are these outside agitators all the way from Moscow who are trying to change our way of life. That's what was happening. But that document was done on the 9th, was published on the 9th of March, 1960, and then, as I said to you earlier, we were out here organizing and lining up what we were going to be doing once that document appeared. On the 15th, at approximately 11:30 in the morning, simultaneously, we hit many places of public accommodations around town. We chose about 11:30 because we wanted to hit the evening news. And we knew that if we did it then, we'd make all the evening news. And I remember being told a few days later by a guy named John Gibson, who is now dead, that he was working, he was a graduate of Moore Hospital, he was working as a waiter at the Dinkler Plaza Hotel, where his father was the maitre d'. They apparently came over the loudspeaker and said that the niggers are sitting in all over Atlanta. And John told me that when that came over the microphone, he stripped off his white his white jacket and shouted, hooray! and came down, and he quit the job and came down and joined the movie with us, and was with us, and also related with Dr. King, until he joined the government later on. So I think that the publication and the actual sit-ins simultaneously really began to galvanize, at least in this time, both communities. It galvanized the black community that a change may be coming. And it galvanized a lot of the white community that we're going to resist this change. Then you run up against the Chamber of Commerce. And I received a call asking that we come down and meet with the Chamber of Commerce in the spring of 1960. At that time,
after the sit-ins,
mm-hmm. after we started, mm-hmm. Alan Allen was the chairperson of the Chamber of Commerce at the time. He later became mayor. He was surrounded by Mills Lane, who headed the CNS Bank, and a bunch of other powerful people. And so I was there with them, along with a couple other students. And they wanted to know more about this movement. What are your goals, ambitions, so forth and so on. It was similar to the college president's meeting, only all these folks were white. And I never forget Mills Lane telling, when it was his time to speak, he said to me that, or to us, that he resented being called a racist because he went to Yale. And you can't be a racist if you've gone to Yale. It's amazing how people, I guess even today, attribute their beliefs sometimes to where they went to school, or they hang their beliefs on any fig leaf that comes by. Lane eventually changed a lot of his overt behavior on the issue of race, but I think everybody in that room that I met with in 1960 who were white were in lockstep. They were concerned about the business climate in Atlanta. They were concerned that we were challenging their stated and their official position in order to encourage business in the South, which was Atlanta's a city too busy to hate. That was a very well-crafted, well-articulated position. Ever since the end of Reconstruction and after white Southerners regained power in the South and in Atlanta, they have always wanted to attract Northern money to help rebuild the South or build up the South. And so Atlanta came up with this campaign, which was a very effective campaign, to bring people down here with money. And what we were doing is that we were going to be doing things that would not be good for business. Because business doesn't like to invest its money where there's controversy. So one of the things that we have to put on the record here is that Atlanta, Georgia was and still is the most sophisticated city in the South. The people who are in the white leadership here, who the power structure of that time, had gone to the best schools. They were men that were multi-millionaires even then, living on big estates. They were above the fray to a great extent, but they were calling the play in terms of what was happening economically. And so we were challenging the status quo. And the bottom line for them was really profit. They wanted to make more money. And we were going to be impacted possibly with all our demonstrations on their bottom line. And they did not like that. But the Atlanta is a lot like America. At least at that time, it may still be today. Atlanta had a duality. What they practiced was different from what they preached. Like America is a democracy. But on one hand, we preach, even from the Declaration of Independence on down through today, certain high ideals. But the actual practices under that umbrella fall far short of what one would view as the promise laid out by the articulating of those ideals. So what we did in the movement in the 1960s, student movement, was challenge America, challenge Atlanta to live up to what it was practicing, to what it preached. In hindsight, the Chamber of Commerce under Ivan Adams' leadership, in my opinion, embarked on a campaign to see how could they subvert the movement, how could they curtail the movement by getting this group of black leaders that were basically under their control to stop us. And that meant then that they had to make sure that Colonel Walden, A.T. Walden, Warren Cochran, and a lot of other people like that, they had to make sure that those folks stayed under their thumb.
Who were some of the others?
John Calhoun was one. Well, when you move beyond Calloway, Cochran, Alexander, Walden, the rest of the people were pretty much second tier. Walden was the colonel. Walden was the head of the Atlanta Negro Voters League. And then there was another man named Jackson, who was a Republican, Reverend Jackson, who was the other co-chairperson. But it was really Walden. And Walden was a lawyer. Finished University of Michigan Law School. I think he might have been the first black graduate of the University of Michigan, Law School. But he was a malleable Negro leader. You have to understand that in the history of Atlanta, a man named William B. Hartsfield was mayor for about 25 years, 24 years, whatever. And during his administration, there was this pact between the political leadership headed by him, the community leadership, or the business leadership headed by Ivan Allen or Mills Lane or somebody like that, and the black leadership headed by Walden. This trica controlled what happened in Atlanta. And because I was able to see all of this when I was a kid, growing up, I had a better understanding of who the players were.
You knew this before the Atlanta student movement.
I knew who was running Atlanta before the Atlanta student movement because I grew up here and I had a chance at the YMCA. You see, I have to understand, the Butler Street YMCA was like a black chamber of commerce in the sense that Cochran was the head of it, the overall thing, and J.D. Winston was the boys club director. But Cochran was one of the most powerful men, black or white, in this state. And most people don't know who he is or who he was. But he was able to call the shots on so many things that you just would not believe back in the 40s and the 50s and early 60s. These powerful black men that I've talked about were able to deliver the vote. And what was going on here is this. There was a struggle in Atlanta between the people who were, I guess you would say, were the descendants of the Klan type mentality, whites, and the people who, like Allen, were kind of descendants of the landed gentry class that took over the South once Reconstruction ended. So you had this confluence then of these two different groups battling for power in Atlanta, in the white community. So if the white conservatives ran a candidate, they couldn't win outright if the whites, who were the landed gentry, coalesced with the blacks. So the black vote became the margin of difference. You follow me?
Yes.
So when you bring them together, you get over 50% of the vote. 17 to 20,000 blacks and about 20,000 whites. You put them together, that's more than the combined total of all the other boys over here. So it was that kind of thinking that was good for business. It was good for Atlanta. That's the kind of history that I don't think many people are aware of as to how Atlanta grew. Hartsfield was the major architect of it for those 20-some years. But, yes.
I'm going to hold here just a minute because this tape is about... Okay.
Let me advance this coalition notion between Hartsfield on the political side, the Chamber of Commerce, white Chamber of Commerce, and the black leadership of the time. This coalition kept Atlanta cool, in quotation marks. What was happening with the students was that we were making the blacks who had been the balance of, the black leadership that had represented the balance of power, we were making them somewhat irrelevant because the power structure white wanted to deal with the folks who could deliver the vote for them. And they also wanted them to get the students to come out and start demonstrating and embarrassing Atlanta. Mr. Walden and his team could not deliver that for them because they could not control us. And that created a real dichotomy for Walden and company as well as for the city leadership. How are we going to control these uncontrollable students? Now, they couldn't do what they normally did, which was to get all the folks fired if they could find out where they worked, or get the mamas fired and daddies fired, because these kids came all over the South and all over the country, so you couldn't vary. It would have been unproductive to try to find a way to fire all these people. So they were stuck with us, and we were uncontrollable. So we kept pushing, and of course we started the Richards boycott. And the reason why we started with Richards, or should I say we singled out Richards as the major two once we really got the campaign going, was because Richards was the major donor in the South, the largest department store in the South. And we felt that the domino theory would work for us if we could topple Richards. Now mind you now, I was an economics major at Morehouse, so I knew something about the margin of profit in a business, the cost of that, and business. The margin of profit for most department stores at that time was somewhere between 5 and 7%, maybe even 11% of gross sales. Well, the black community made up about 30-some percent of the population, and if you interpolate that this is the biggest store and we shop there too, that means that about 30% of that business is going to be black. But if the margin of profit is 2/3 less than that, what you've got to do then is get the 30% to stop shopping. And if you get that 30% to stop shopping, then you're going to force the people to start making concessions. But what do you want? Because again, it is the dollar that is motivating these people. Well, the domino theory goes like this. As one, when you find the major force and you knock that one down, the rest of the people or the other entities will fall like dominoes. John Foster Dulles, who was Secretary of State at that time, articulated the domino theory in Southeast Asia, again, based on communism. If the communists get a beachhead in Area A in Southeast Asia, the rest of Southeast Asia will be like dominoes. It will fall, and we'll all have to deal with a communist Southeast Asia in the Southeast Asian basin. So when you apply that theory to Richards Department Store and desegregation, in Atlanta as well as in the South, then you realize that riches is the place for us to go. And so we did do that. We put the campaign on riches, and we did a lot of things before we ever got to the October 19th big time when Martin came. We began an education campaign during the summer of 1960. And that campaign was aided by a publication that we started called The Student Movement and You. And we put out about 20,000 copies of that every Sunday at all these churches. And the reason we had to do it was twofold. One was to get people educated to the fact that we wanted to boycott downtown because we represent the margin of profit for the downtown business community. Secondarily, the paper stopped writing about what was happening in the other cities.
Why?
Because it was, they felt, in my view, that it was going to incite or reinforce. Because what was happening is that cities began to desegregate that was further north. And each time you heard about another city falling, quote, to our forces, our other young people, that encouraged us. So if you don't hear about any victories and you're out here battling, then you wonder, well, maybe this is not the right thing to do. A lot of this is psychological, okay? So we wanted to be able to tell the population, don't worry about whether or not the Atlanta Journal Constitution has written about it. Here's what's happening in Nashville, what's happening in Greensboro, what's happening in Birmingham. And we articulated that to them by calling our friends that we knew in those different places to find out what was going on. And I asked Julian to write that for us. And so he was the editor of the Student Movement and New Publication for us, he and Mary Ann Smith and some other people. We also used the publication to ask people to send to us their richest charge card. We actually got people to send in to us their credit cards, and we put them at Citizens Trust Bank in a safe deposit box until the movement was over, or the walkout was over, and we sent them back to them. The slogan was simply this: close down your account with segregation, open up your account with freedom. And it worked. It worked. Now, while we were going against riches, I sat in down there at the meeting there in Magnolia Room, summer of 1960, June, July, whatever, I have to look that up. And got arrested. They closed the Magnolia Room, and the policeman took me to, in their patrol car, to the chief of police's office, down on Decatur Street.
Jenkins.
So when I got there to Jenkins' conference room, it was sitting Dick Rich, who was the head of Rich's department store. He didn't run it, but he was the head of it. A man named Frank Neely actually ran it. So Jenkins said that Rich wanted to talk to me and he was going to be the broker between us. And so Rich gave me a lecture. Condescending.
You alone?
Yeah, I was alone.
Okay.
Yeah. He gave me a lecture on what he was going to do to me if I came back down to Rich's and brought a band of students with me.
And what was he going to do?
He was going to have my ass arrested.
He used that word?
Yes. And he and I got into a verbal exchange that was kind of jaded. The only profane word was that one that he used. And I gave him a lecture about freedom and opportunity and that we were not turning back. And so the end of it was simply this. He gave me a challenge. You come back to my store and I will arrest you and put you in jail and let you stay in jail. We won't do it like this. And I told him that get ready because we will be back. And when I came back, we came back, I brought back thousands of people with me on October the 19th. And also we ringed his store with pickets. And then the Klan sent word through their press people that they were coming to town on Saturday to challenge us. So, and if you go back and look at some of the old pictures, you'll see where on one side of Richards, we had ringed the entire store. And then across the street, the Klan had put deaf people around the store of a home, which is now the Sam Nunn building. The end result of that, though, was that nobody came into the stores, black or white, because of all of the... So it really helped us a great deal. Anyway, that takes us up to the King arrest, but let's put a pin right there for a moment and take you back to the birth of the Atlanta Inquirer.
Okay.
After the movement began, I got a telephone call from a man named Kossuth Hill. Kossuth Hill, begins with a K. His wife's name was Genevieve Hill, who was the head of the School of Social Work at AU. I can't spell Kossuth's name.
I'll find it.
Anyway, he was the head of Hill Office Supply on Auburn Avenue, one across the street from the Atlanta Life Insurance Company's old building. Mr. Hill asked me to come by his office. He wanted to talk to me, so I went up there and he said, I'm thinking about starting a newspaper, he said, because Mr. Scott is not doing right about the movement. Because Mr. Scott was basically against everything that we were doing.
Why?
I think that Mr. Scott was a scared person who felt that you ought to let the lawyers handle everything and we ought to be in class. I guess you'd have to say, the most generous term I guess I can make in describing Mr. Scott is that he was an Uncle Tom. I mean, that's the most generous thing I can say about him. Because it was outrageous to consider some of the stuff, when you consider some of the stuff that he was doing against us. Oh, he was editorializing against us. He was coming to meetings. Where we formed something called the student movement, the Atlanta Student Adult Liaison Committee, headed by Reverend Borders and me. And he would come to those meetings and he would just rail against what we were doing. I mean it was embarrassing to just see a black man doing that. But then when you see a Clarence Thomas and some other folks today, you realize that he was just a forerunner for these kind of people. Anyway, Mr. Hill, to go back to that story, said he was going to start this paper called Atlanta Inquirer. And he'd ask a guy named Bill Strong, Morehouse graduate, to be the editor. And that they were going to support the movement, this new weekly. And he started it.
And it was called what?
The Atlanta Inquirer.
Okay.
Well, they asked us for some help, and so what we did is I asked James Gibson, John Gibson's brother, Charlene Hunter, who had finished high school, and was supposed to go to Georgia whenever the courts ruled in our favor. Alice Clopton, Julian Bond's first wife, a number of people, students, we asked them to help write the paper for them. Then, at some point during the spring of 1960, after the Inquirer came on the market, Mr. Strong fell out with Mr. Hill for some reason. And so I asked Mr. Carl Holman if he'd be willing to serve as the editor and work with them.
Work with Hill?
No, with him, yes.
Okay.
And Hill decided to sell out for some reason. I don't know what that was about. And then we had to go and get some investors to keep it going. And that's when we brought in a man named Jesse Hill, who had been working with me earlier. Brought in Johnny Johnson, John Gibson's mother, Clint Warner, people like that. But then, all of a sudden, Miss Marin, I got a telephone call from Mr. Q.B. Williamson and Mr. Calloway, They wanted to talk to me about the Empire Real Estate Board ads that had been put into the Atlanta World. They put them in every Sunday. They said that they resented what Mr. Scott was doing. And we're going to pull all the ads out of the Atlanta World and put them in the Atlanta Inquirer, this new paper. Now, you know, that was dramatic because the newspapers during that time was full of real estate ads. I mean, like you see the grocery store ads, we had the real estate ads like that. Atlanta was booming, trying to move west. They took them out.
Because they were committed to the movement?
Yes. They took all the ads and put them in the Atlanta Inquirer. Oh, Mr. Scott was angry about that. But that helped buttress and support the Inquirer. Then, during that same summer, as the Inquirer was developing, and as we have been writing the student movement in you, and we stopped writing it because the Inquirer now is ready to write our own stuff for us, and so they gave me a column called Let Freedom Ring. That's what I named it. And we wrote that column, and Julian and all the rest, they all wrote the paper, basically, for all practical purposes. Well, along comes an idea, I'm not sure whose idea it was, that we ought to not only push the boycott downtown, but we need to take a look at economic opportunity. And at one of our meetings, it was proposed that
it was a meeting of COR?
Yeah, okay. Radio Appeal. It was proposed that we begin a boycott of grocery stores. So we boycotted one on Hightower and got them to hire a black lady as a cashier there. We boycotted the AMPs and Colonial stores. And we also boycotted Mann Brothers in West End.
Because
we wanted jobs as butchers, cashiers. Black folks were highly visible in terms of the patronage for these places, but the only jobs that you could hold were jobs as menial jobs, janitors. And we were just looking to get some upper mobility kind of positions. Just a butcher cutting meat. It sounds crazy now, but that was a big deal during that time. So our boycotts were 97% effective in almost every area, and so these people began to capitulate to us, some of them. With regard to Colonial stores, the Southeastern Regional Manager for Colonial called Mr. Scott and threatened to take the $9,000 ad out of his paper from their stores if he couldn't stop us from boycotting stores. So Mr. Scott called me to his office and lectured me. Mind you now, everyone else think, when you are a college student, certainly during that time, and somebody else was an adult, they didn't respect you that much. I mean, they talked to you like you were a little dog, you know. I mean, they were very, very condescending. And so I let Mr. Scott go on and rant and rail about how I was running his business and this, that, and the other. And he was demanding that I call the student boycott off because his $9,000 ad was at stake. And I remember what I had told the college presidents earlier about in every revolution there's probably some casualties. And I told Mr. Scott, Mr. Scott, I'm not going to call this boycott off. I said, the price of freedom for African Americans, no, Negroes in Atlanta is worth more than $9,000. And so, if they're going to take your ad, I'm sorry, but I'm not calling this boycott off. Mr. Scott hated me until he died, to be honest with you, but that was what happened. And of course, we won the boy battle. They The Teamsters came in to join us, so it really got to be a big deal. So they started hiring, you know, people as we wanted them to. But again, this was a part of a broader educational campaign with small victories, but it was beginning to show people that if you pull together, you can win some victories, even if they were small. Now, we went everywhere that summer. Everywhere you get two folks together, we were sending some students to talk. We were always out talking to some church somewhere, all during the week. Any social clubs, you name it, talking up the boycott. So, by the time the fall of 1960 comes, our students are back, our troops are back. And we had laid out the plan. We said, we're going to put the issue of discrimination in America into the political campaign in 1960. John Kennedy, by that time, was...
Who said that?
That's what we all said.
Okay.
I was one of them.
Okay.
I mean, I was a champion, okay?
All right.
And I brought the issue to our committee. And I got them to agree to do this. We actually sent out telegrams to John Kennedy and to Richard Nixon. I'm trying to get copies of those from their people. Asking them to take a stand on what was happening in the South.
Not just in Atlanta.
No, in the South, on
okay.
the whole issue.
Mm-hmm.
John Calhoun, who was a master organizer, whose name I mentioned to you earlier, was a big Republican in Atlanta and in the country. He tried his best to get Richard Nixon to respond. Nixon refused to respond. John Kennedy did not respond directly. He responded through his brother, calling Coretta King. You know, because what happened is that we went down there later. In other words, once we sent out telegrams, we got everybody organized for the October 19th big event.
Mm-hmm.
Sit-ins all over the place.
King is not yet in jail at that time?
King did not go to jail until we asked him to come and join us. And they put
on the
him
19th?
In jail. On the 19th,
okay,
yeah.
I got you.
King had never been in jail voluntarily before the 19th of October. He had been to jail because the Birmingham people came to get him, or he was arrested that one time when he was driving Lydia Smith to the airport.
Mm-hmm.
But I mean, in terms of going to jail where we had a jail, no bail, he hadn't done that until we convinced him to go in October of 1960. But anyway,
what kind of organizing did you all have to do to get to that point? Here you were focusing on the presidential election.
Yeah, let me just say this. We were organizing, we had picked out our sites for where we were going to begin our campaign on the 19th.
Mm-hmm.
And we chose Richard's as the focal point, and that I and Martin were going to go to the bridge cafeteria.
Okay.
Well, we never heard from Kennedy directly. We heard from Kennedy's, John, from his brother. Now, Martin told me that he would go with me, because I felt that he ought to do that. However, when I asked Herschel Sullivan to call him and tell him exactly where to meet me the next morning, he told her on the 19th that he was not going to. No, he told her on the 18th, because we met up over at Dr. Spellman, he told her that he had been advised not to do it. And, of course, that came, I think, from his father and others who were around him, because he was on probation out of Alabama. Well, I called him and told him, and of course, on the line was his brother, his daddy, a whole bunch of other folks, about four or five folks on the party line, extensions. So as we talked, I heard all the reasons why he should not go. But having known him since 1945, when I joined the church back there, and that was the advantage I had with a lot of people. I knew them from when I was a little boy. I started speaking directly to him, not to his advisors, not to his daddy, but to him, and reminded him of our conversation earlier. And so he and I just talked, and I saw that he was really on the fence about it. I finally said something. I said, well, ML, you can't lead from the back. And when I said that, it was silent. He said, LC, you better call me LC. He said, what time and where tomorrow? I said, meet me on the bridge at 10 o'clock. And so he said, I'll see you then. And the rest almost is history, because he showed up. And it was a catalyst around this country when the leader of the Montgomery bus boycott, who had now moved to Atlanta, got arrested. It was all over the world. And in black communities around America, this was 2 weeks before the 1960 campaign was over, black communities in Philadelphia and New York and Detroit and Los Angeles and Chicago, they all switched and voted Democratic. Now mind you now, the African-American community was not necessarily Democratic. A lot of them were Republicans in 1960. Lincoln Republicans, they're not these kind of folks that we have now, but Lincoln Republicans, because Lincoln had, quote, freed the slaves, unquote. They switched. So that vote became, that act was the catalyst that became the margin of victory. And many people wrote about it during that time. You don't hear it now, but that's what was written during that time. But there was one city, Miss Merritt, that did not go with the black communities around the country and switch from being Republican. And guess where that city was?
Atlanta.
Atlanta, Georgia. Atlanta still voted Republican in the black community. But you know why? Because John Calhoun was a master organizer. The best I have ever seen. He taught me how to organize. The man was a genius at it. And he delivered the votes for Richard Nixon. It didn't make any difference because of the other, but the point is, he did his job where he lived. So we've gone up from the time we began the movement through 1960, October, and this major event that was a catalyst. Now, Martin and I were in jail together, the same cell, and we were there for several days, and then when we finally decided to come out from jail, because we could come out at almost any time if we even wanted to, they wouldn't let Martin go, because by this time, what he was afraid of, or his advisors, happened. They took him out to DeKalb County, because I think it was this thing with Lillian Smith, I believe.
Was that Emory, right?
Yeah. And put him in jail. Judge Mitchell had some role to play in that. And Bobby Kennedy, very deftly from a political point of view, made it appear as though he was trying to get Martin out, and his brother was concerned. And in fact, in the long run, Martin did get out from Reedsville. But it was, you know, these white politicians like Kennedy had to somehow or another walk that thin line. They didn't want to make it appear as though they were really pro-black, but at the same time, they had to act like they were pro-black in the black community. You see, any scintilla of acceptance at that time went a long way in the black community, because everybody who was in a political power position in America, to a great extent, made it very clear that they were white first. It was white interest first. And if there were some crumbs, you might get a little bit. So if we had some degree of recognition as a stepchild in this democracy, we responded in a positive way. Okay? So we go on and we begin to continue boycotting. We set up a communication system where we began the hit and run lunch counters. They would close it. The tactic was to close the lunch counters whenever the students showed up. We'd close them down, and then we'd go back and get in the car, and we'd go, and they would let us know. We had spotters who would let us know when other lunch counters had opened. And so we'd just go and close down some others, and then, but we'd leave a spot at the first one, And the time they'd open back up, we'd come back because we had a radio communication and close it down again. We ran them crazy, but they don't.
How did you support that radio communication?
We had a young man by the name of Ronald Yancey, who went on from Morehouse to Georgia Tech, who put all that together. It was a two-way communication system. We had a command central at our headquarters, and so we.
And your headquarters were with
our
you.
Headquarters. We started with AU, with Dr. Clement's offices, and then we moved over to Providence Baptist Church, and then we moved into Rush Memorial down on Brawley, which used to be Chestnut. Mm-hmm. So the largest period of our time was spent on Chestnut Street at the Rush Memorial Church. Reverend Joe Boone gave us his upstairs there. Mm-hmm.
So at what point were you all at Mutual Federal? I thought I saw...
We were in Mutual Federal's office building in the summer of 1960. Just in that summer.
Okay.
Yeah. We didn't have anywhere to go that summer, see? And so we just went
down.
School
was out.
School was out. And we had been at Providence, but Providence couldn't take us any longer. So we went down there for the summer. And then in the fall, we went over to Rush Memorial. And we stayed at Rush all the way through.
Okay. Was there any support from Atlanta Life Insurance Company?
Oh, yes.
What kind?
Oh, yes. Atlanta Life. We've got to talk about that. Jesse Hill came over to Atlanta University one evening when I was speaking during the spring of 1960. Brought his two daughters with him. He came up to me after I spoke, and he offered to provide any assistance that he could, because he was an actuary at Atlanta Life, came here from St. Louis, hadn't been here that long. So, I remember that. I took his name down. And Jesse was always around offering help. And he was a part of this ACA group also. And Whitney Young was tied into it too. I forgot to mention Whitney Young. So, when we had our first picket line downtown, we had handmade signs. So I got a call from Mr. Hill, who told me that Mr. Martin, E.M. Martin, wanted to talk to me. Well, E.M. Martin was the person who ran Atlanta Life for Mr. Herndon. So I went down to see Mr. Martin, who I had heard of, but I didn't know the man. And I got in there and saw this gentleman that I thought was white, you know. Sat down with him, and he congratulated me on what we were trying to do, and he said, but I got a concern. I said, what's that? He said, I don't like the way those picket signs look. And I said, okay. He said, you need to have professionally drawn up picket signs. It's an image game. I said, well, we can't afford it. He said, I'm assigning Maurice Pennington to make these signs for you. He's a charge of our print shop. I'm telling him to make up all the signs you need. And if you look at our signs, we didn't have any pitiful signs except those first ones. Because Mr. Martin directed Atlanta Life staff to make up all the signs. Okay, how many we needed? Make them up. Additionally, Mr. Martin offered the Atlanta Life meeting room inside the back of the headquarters anytime we wanted it. So every Wednesday, Reverend Borders and I called a meeting of the community leadership, preachers, and everybody to give them a report firsthand on what was happening in the movement. That was Atlanta Life. Mr. Martin also had Atlanta Life employees, most of whom were women, to go and man the picket lines on their lunch hours for us to help us out. So, Atlanta Life Insurance Company was one of the strongest supporters of the civil rights movement during the time I was the leader here. And I've learned later, I'm reading history, that they had a history of doing that for the National NAACP. Walter White was Mr. E.M. Martin's brother-in-law. I did not know that until, because he never mentioned that. So, they were very strong, Atlanta Life, in that effort. Additionally, we were able to get Mr. Maurice Pennington to become the cartoonist for the Atlanta Inquirer. If you go back and look at some of the early issues of Atlanta Inquirer, you will see the cartoons by Pennington. They were poignant cartoons, extremely. Herb Locke, those guys who were internationally famous as cartoonists, could not do it any better than Maurice Pennington.
What about bail money?
Well, when we went to jail in 1960, in the first big one, Mr. QB Williamson led that effort along with other members of the Empire Real Estate Board. He was the head of the Empire Real Estate Board at the time. So they put up money. They put up their homes in order to bail us out of jail. They also got bail's bond on Decatur Street to help us out. But that came from the doctors, the lawyers, but primarily the real estate people who put up their homes in order to bail us out of jail. We didn't do jail on bail initially. We went to jail, but we were bailed out. It was later that we took up the jail on bail thing in October. Mm-hmm. We didn't talk about the organization of SNCC.
Right.
Yeah. Let me talk about that for a moment, and maybe we can splice some of this. As I said to you earlier, early on, if you look at the newspaper accounts, you will find that Virginia passed anti-trespassing laws as a way of trying to stop the students. And after Virginia did it, North Carolina, I mean, it was like wildfire, all going all around the South and Southwest. So the Committee on Appeal, CORE, we were talking about these issues, and we, as a group, said, we can't win this battle against an organized opposition like this. These people are all connected in some way or another. So for us to win, we need to organize also. And so we decided that I would go, because I was one who knew Martin King, to see Martin, and Julian and Marion went with me to ask him to call this meeting in Raleigh. To call a meeting of all the students, leaders that we could identify, and have them come to over Easter weekend to talk about organizing a Southwide youth movement to break down these barriers. He brought in Ella Baker to the meeting, and Ella Baker had gone to Shaw, and so she arranged it for Easter weekend at Shaw University. But the idea started with the Atlanta committee. Julian, Mary, and I took it to King, who in turn had the prestige because he was the Montgomery hero, call that meeting. And that's how SNCC got started. Now, King wanted to make SNCC into like a junior arm of SCLC, but we weren't prepared to do that. Somewhere along the line, he and Ella Baker also got cross-eyed. And, you know, so far, I don't know what that was about, and I never did ask either one of them about it.
What do you recall of that meeting in Raleigh, that Easter weekend?
Well,
April 1960.
We probably had 200 or 300 people there from all over the place. The political dynamics, I think, were SCLC types wanted it to go in one direction, headed by King. You had the Nashville group wanting it to go in another direction, headed by Jim Lawson. And then you had the Atlanta group, headed by me, wanting to go into another direction. And what happened is this, there were two names put in nomination, or at least discussed who was going to head SNCC at the time. And so my name was brought forward to head SNCC, and Marion Barry's name was brought forward to head SNCC. Now, Marion was a little known, no one ever heard of Marion, because the person that we had heard about from Nashville was Lawson, but he was not a student. And Diane Nash, who was a student. So here was the battle. Is it going to be King or is it going to be Barry? So they made a compromise. The compromise was, we'll name Barry chairperson and we'll move SNCC to Atlanta. And so Barry would be chairman in Nashville, but the organization would be headquartered in Atlanta. And the Atlanta movement was going to pay the rent, and all the bills for the first year or so. And that's what happened. We actually paid the rent and so forth. They were down, we had the building, we were at Mutual Federal's building, second floor. So we rented the building, rented an office for them down the hall from us. And we paid that rent for about the first year, 18 months.
Were they, was SNCC then there in that Mutual Federal building for a year?
That summer, yes.
That summer?
Summer, and also into the fall, too.
Okay. And where did y'all get the money to pay for SNCC?
Lord. It was only $50 a month at that time.
Okay.
Yeah, but we had money. The doctors gave us money. We didn't bother the money that Clement had, but we raised money from the doctors gave us money. And we had a few hundred dollars, but let me tell you where else we had money though. We put together some Christmas cards. I don't know whether you've ever seen those cards or not, have you?
I haven't.
Okay, we hired an artist who's still in town, by the way. I saw her the day before yesterday. Mm-hmm. I might ask her if she's still. We put together some Christmas cards to add to the money that we already had gotten in donations. Mm-hmm. And they were Freedom Christmas cards. And we raised for $4,000 or $5,000 just in cards. And that's, we had a lot of money to run this movement in Atlanta that came from different innovative things that we did. But can you imagine, that was a lot of money in 1960, $4,000, but we had it.
Okay, so you were supporting you paid for the rent of SNCC.